Hello and welcome to today's book reading session of Preparing for the Day After. Preparing for the Day After is a photojournalistic treatise on disaster mitigation published by me, Malini Shankar, and Walter Keller for the 10th anniversary of the Asian tsunami. Tonight we will study the need for COVID-19 compatible architecture in the post-COVID-19 era and how we can contextualize it for Indian needs within the Sustainable Development Goals framework. However, I must clarify that no COVID-related topics are found in the original work published in December 2014. Let us first recap what we have learned in the previous book reading sessions before starting tonight's session. Water and sanitation is central to developmental discourse. Livelihoods based on local agro-meteorological conditions are the best means of ensuring livelihood security. Culture-sensitive food security also has evolved out of agro-meteorological conditions prevalent in an area. Climate change adaptation, menstrual hygiene for indigenous people, tribal women especially, solid waste management, universal healthcare access, sustainable development goals, they are all factors to be included in the developmental agenda. COVID-19 has taught us that maximizing profits by unrealistic expansion of any enterprise is not only unsustainable but plain dangerous. This was especially true in the field of real estate development. Where once independent houses stood with spacious rooms and a couple of toilets, real estate development bordering on extreme avariciousness has led to construction of multi-storied edifices, often with commercial establishments built next to living spaces. This has congested water supply and sanitation and triggered unplanned fiscal growth. We are given to believe that outlandishly priced apartment blocks are the ultimate in luxury. In reality, though, what has happened is multiple sanitation systems trickling down multiple terraces has triggered compromised sanitation. In the post-COVID-19 era, social distancing will be the norm. We thus need to adapt our dwellings and workspaces to defer to this new rule. One room can and should accommodate a maximum of 3 persons each, sitting at a distance of a minimum 6 feet from another person. That calls for a large amount of space. Every room should have wide windows, cross ventilation, and natural lighting. Because without fresh air circulating inside the room, wearing a mask in an air-conditioned atmosphere tantamounts to breathing carbon monoxide that you would have breathed out, and it's also very expensive and climate detrimental, so to say. When the lockdowns were lifted, people went back to their offices. They sat in an airtight compartment with air conditioning, throwing all caution to the winds and shut the windows tight. They sat cozily inside, breathing the exhaled air, so to say. People were vulnerable to aerosol-borne infections even before the pandemic was declared an end too. No wonder black fungus infections are increasing 1 year after people have started using the mask or wearing the mask, which is also necessary, but you need to adapt. It needs to be made out of cotton, no synthetic masks, and no airtight compartments. So, lesson to be learned is that no compromise can be made as far as fresh air circulation, good light, and cross ventilation are concerned. Social distancing must be heeded. I repeat, no more than 3 persons can occupy a room. So furniture and ventilation must be so designed as to allow for fresh air circulation, cross ventilation, and good natural light. This calls for a whole readaptation of architectural best practices. Thus, COVID-19 compatible architecture calls for reinventing the wheel, so to say. Traditional architecture, in hindsight, as well as all tenets of traditional wisdom, which were discarded in favor of commercialization or increase in profits, have to be readapted in a COVID-19 perspective. Let us look at the merits of traditional architecture today. Sloping tiled roofs in one-storied buildings offers natural light and cross ventilation. Single-storied buildings offer more per capita space. Besides, single-storied structures built in vernacular architectural style offers good ventilation, fresh air, natural light, and offer scope for users to utilize water and sanitation sustainably. There is also space for setbacks, gardens, green cover, kitchen garden, buffer areas, verandas, piles, utility areas in the open. In traditional architecture, we have scope for an indoor barnyard or a granary too. Separate bathrooms and toilets, bedrooms, kitchens, dining halls, living or family rooms, verandas can be designed in a one-story traditionally designed vernacular architecture based building or a house. Cross ventilation, fresh air and natural light should not be compromised in COVID-19 compatible architecture. No more need for large dining tables that can accommodate 14 persons, I dare say. In a way, COVID-19 has mandated nuclear families and smaller sustainable economic units at workplace. Every room has to have large windows with green cover lacing the windows. Across the windows on the opposite side of the window, there must be another source of fresh air and natural light. Usually, the door is placed opposite the window. This cannot be done in multi-storied or multi-terraced apartment blocks. Single-storied constructions with a central courtyard open to the sky satisfies the need for cross ventilation, natural light and fresh air. Besides, with separate rooms for specific needs, larger rooms will be able to accommodate a maximum of 3 persons at 2 arms length. COVID-19 compatible architecture needs buffer spaces like corridors, courtyards, sanitizing infrastructure, as different from sanitation infrastructure, and a buffer from say the toilets. Yes, I understand. Space is at a premium, especially in urban areas. If one goes by sustainable architecture in accordance with traditional wisdom, the construction will literally be horizontal and inclusive. It needs repurposing and redefining land use planning. Also, it needs an educated population which can respect and defer to the laws and heeding to the laws. There should be a discipline, a social discipline. There cannot be erratic construction based on one's own needs without conforming or deferring to the laws. And that calls for transparent governance and corruption-free administration. That would ensure inclusive fiscal development in semi-urban and rural areas, mainstreaming development inclusively, sustainably. But to congest occupancy is a compromise on health, hygiene and sanitation. The commercialization of real estate or construction industry seems to suit the builders rather than those who have to own and live in the property. One-story construction, especially with vernacular architecture and new concepts like earthen architecture, will not only make construction financially sustainable, but more inclusive and ideal to cater to the needs of a post-pandemic recovery phase. Vernacular architecture is always agrometeorological in character and defers to the local weather, humidity, precipitation, rainfall, all factors that impact agricultural produce. No wonder then architectural material used for construction of buildings in the style of vernacular architecture uses local materials only. Vernacular architecture is found in deference to the local agrometeorological conditions across the whole world. There are some pictures that's coming up in today's video. Earth is being used in different forms as building materials, scientifically known as loam. Loam is a mixture of clay, silt, sand and occasionally larger aggregates such as gravel and sand. Varying the proportions of these contents, different earth building techniques can be opted for. Blocks of earth produced manually by throwing a wet mix of earth, water and straw fiber into a form of work are called adobes or mud bricks, or even sun-dried earth blocks. Mud bricks are laid with a mud mortar and can be used to build walls, vaults, and domes. Virtually all the energy input for mud brick construction is human labor, and after a lifetime of use, the bricks break down and into the earth and where they come from. So it becomes part of the earth again. That is the greatest advantage of earthen construction. When moist earth is compacted in a manual or power press, then the blocks formed are called CEB or compressed earth block. Alternatively, a small percentage of cement or lime is added to the mix to make the blocks that are called CSEB or compressed stabilized earth blocks. Stabilized rammed earth is a variant of traditional rammed earth that adds a small amount of cement, typically 5-10%, to increase strength and surface durability. Rammed earth has been well known for centuries as a traditional wall construction technique. In this technique, moist earth is poured into a formwork in layers of about 15 centimeters thick and then compacted by ramming. The formwork usually consists of two parallel walls separated and interconnected by spacers. Unlike adobe, it is monolithic, which adds to the longevity of the walls. Corb is one of the most common building techniques. It is made by mixing local soil on site, sand, straw and water, and hand worked into a monolithic structure. Unlike other methods, no formwork, cement, ramming or machines are used in this technique. It is completely hand sculpted and is the most organic way of building. It has a very complex, multi-dimensional, interwoven straw in reinforcement, which makes it very strong, helping to withstand lateral loads in case of an earthquake. Features like central courtyard, tiles for sloping roofs, corridors, etc., highlight so many different concepts all at once. Central courtyards are the center of gravity, thus it helps as earthquake-safe architecture. It also becomes the receptacle to harvest rainwater. The natural light in the central courtyard offers not just natural light but also circulation of fresh air. Consequently, it keeps the entire construction cool. If built with earthen material like rammed earth, mud blocks or laterite, sandstone, etc., and bamboo instead of steel, wattle and daub, and without cement, then the entire construction will be so cool that there will be no need for air conditioning. Air conditioning is not just climate neutral, air conditioning is not just climate detrimental, but has to be avoided in the post-COVID era for fear of circulating stale air. If there is a tree in the central courtyard, it also generates fresh oxygen for free circulation of fresh air. The tree can also host innumerable birds and squirrels. If it is a fruit-bearing tree, one can further have direct access to food off the tree branch. Significantly, the central courtyard serves as a buffer zone between private and public areas of the house or the building, thus giving sanitation a new meaning and significance in post-COVID-19 era. Ventilation can also be aided by dormers or windows on sloping tiled roofs. Another advantage of sloping roof is it minimizes the usage of reinforced cement concrete, thus cooling the constructed area significantly. RCC or reinforced cement concrete ought to be used only for earthquake safe construction. Usage of earthen materials in construction is a new fad but certainly cost effective. There are different kinds of earthen material that can be used in construction. These are rammed earth, adobe, lateritic dressed stone, sandstone, bamboo, mud, wattle and daub, rock, clay bricks and soil stabilized mud bricks. We've just gone over in detail the definitions and the introduction to these kinds of techniques. Rammed earth, which is made up of 70% of mud or topsoil, excavated on site and mixed with cow dung, water, rice husk, water jelly, stone or pulverized gneiss, rock and cement. It is cooling in nature, inexpensive, healthier and solid. There is no fear of burglary with a rammed earth outer wall. I can assure you that. Adobe is a construction using mud and gravel from the site where the construction is to be made. Mud blocks are made with soil and gravel, and these mud blocks are then plastered by mud plaster in a certain proportion of mud and water. Adobe construction is porous, permitting air circulation even within walls. Laurie Baker School of Construction advocates using all kinds of waste material, including discarded glass and plastic bottles, wrought iron, discarded clothes, and so on. India's Vastu Shastra or traditional school of architecture prescribes kitchen and stove at the southeastern corner of the plinth area or construction. The science behind this tenet is that the early morning light falling into the kitchen will prevent coagulation or condensification of, say, milk products. Sloping roof with tiles ensure high ceiling, at least higher than the RCC roof. High ceiling facilitates cross ventilation and circulation of air because of a gap between wall and sloping roof. Wide windows and doors spaced at geometrically significant places in the room makes it well ventilated. Alternates for roof tiles include shingles, clay, filler slabs, terracotta tiles, sandbags filled with sand and covered by mud plaster. Latticed clay bricks for walls give it a filigree effect, offering great cross ventilation and a cool breeze all day for tropical biomes in India, Indonesia, Sri Lanka, countries of Southeast Asia, tropical Central American countries, Mediterranean countries, North Africa, etc. Louvered window frames made preferably with bamboo, as it is easy to replenish, will offer cool breeze indoors all day long. You don't have to net the windows with plastic mesh to prevent insects from coming in. Treated bamboo used as louvered window frames have to be planned and placed to mitigate heat from sunlight, but not to block the sunlight. This requires planning. East and west facing windows have to be smaller. North and south facing windows can be wider. Ventilation windows can be covered by light colored glass, giving it creative flavors. Skylight in roof tiles or in the roof itself gives ample amount of sunlight. But care must be taken to make sure it does not leak rain water during the monsoons. Skylight not just gives you ample natural light, but effectively decreases your electricity consumption. Without these components of traditional architecture, I would dare say, by commercializing architecture and construction, there have been rapid compromises in sanitation, cross ventilation, and natural light inflow in so-called modern construction. Water consumption too will be far more sustainable in one-storied, traditionally designed architecture. The tenets of traditional architecture are so necessary for post-COVID-19 pandemic compatible architecture. I will now quote from a blog by John Rocha on the advantages of traditional architecture. The link of this blog has been uploaded in the description box below the video. Comparative relationship between traditional architecture and modern architecture. Modern and traditional architecture can definitely coexist, but to what extent do you agree to this fact? Asks the interviewer of John Rocha. Natural materials are mostly used, including teak wood, linen, leather, while the lines are straight. The furniture is usually raised from the floor with legs to have an airy and open atmosphere. The colors used in modern architecture are neutral shades that have a combination of other colors. The walls are generally painted with cream and white colors, but the floor is made of cement or bare wood. Sculptures and paintings form an important part of modern design. Traditional architecture is mainly classified as historical houses that feature many characters and culture embedded into them to give them a unique appearance. In some locations where there is a scarcity of building material, natural materials such as bamboo, thatched or sticks, mud or grass are used for construction instead of sending materials from a distant place. One of the major advantages traditional architecture has over its modern type is that the construction materials are very cheap, affordable, and easily available, requiring relatively little labor. Traditional buildings are more costly to build than modern homes, thus making them the most durable during catastrophes and calamities. Modern architecture has a simple structure that makes its construction easy so that it can be finished in time. As a result of this, modern architecture makes it possible to meet the increasing large demands of new homes these days. Buildings with traditional sense are a nice way to put the past history in memory and showcase ancient scenes. Therefore, some new buildings are important to be built in traditional styles. Modern architecture usually uses steel infrastructure for its construction, where the interior columns bear most of the load. The benefits of vernacular architecture include capitalizing on local knowledge and traditions, taking advantage of local materials and resources means that they are relatively energy efficient and sustainable, providing a vital connection between humans and environment in which they live. Vernacular or traditional architecture emphasizes its utilitarian value, and the significance of its aesthetics comes from its local significance, both in terms of look as well as utility. According to an article on CRAM, the link of which is put up in the description box below the video, and I quote now, quote, vernacular architecture began when people had to make use of the environment around them in order to afford themselves protection and comfort as a response to a changing climate. Vernacular architecture, in reference to local geology, environment, and agro-meteorological produce, is the best means of protection against the elements. It is a simple approach to a building's most basic requirements and a direct style of architecture created according to exact context. Due to the fact that only local materials are used to create such building, as well as only the local builder's skills were used to compose every built structure, these buildings innately reflect on the culture and traditions of both the people and the area. Unquote. Now, that is all we have for tonight's session on critical significance of cross ventilation in a post-COVID-19 era. In the next week's session, we shall study bamboo as building material. Bamboo is the new steel. We will see next week how bamboo can be utilized for various applications, including construction. Don't forget to tune in for the live interaction around 7:30 p.m. Indian time on Saturday, 15th May 2021, for an interaction on today's lecture, that is a need for cross ventilation and COVID-19 compatible architecture. In case of any questions or suggestions, please feel free to email me or to log in your comments in the comment section below. Until next week, take care, stay home, stay safe, keep smiling, and ciao.